So, good morning, everyone. First, I have an announcement. If you're a woman who takes off her necklace when you shower, then come to me afterwards, especially if it's a round necklace. So, see me afterwards. I've been given the task of being the chair for the first time when the sessions are really short, so I don't know what that implies of how Phil perceives me, but I'll try to do my best. And then I was also given a session with very hard names to read. So the first talk is The Left Over Hashlema Revisited. It's by Boaz Barak, Yevgeny Dodis, Hugo Kravchik, Olivier Pereira, Krzysztof Petzak, François Xavier Standart, and you. And Yevgeny is going to be giving the talk. Okay, Yevgeny, I'm pressing the... Oh, you're still not done?
Hello?
Yevgeny, okay. Don't forget your time there.
Okay,
20 minutes.
Thanks, Tal. Okay, so I'm going to be talking about leftover Hashlema and revisit it, so I'll define all the terms. So let me start by talking about imperfect random sources. We all know that randomness is very important in many areas of computer science, but it is especially important in cryptography because secret keys have to be random and unknown to the attacker. Unfortunately, in practical situations, we often have to deal with imperfect sources of randomness, such as physical sources, biometric data. But also, even if the data was originally random, there is this whole class of side channel attacks and other kind of forms of leakage that the attacker can get about your secret key, such as conditioned on the attacker's partial information, your key, which was originally random, is no longer random from the perspective of the attacker. So, and also another problem, which is also very, very important, is when we do, for example, Diffie-Hellman key exchange or some kind of key exchange based on public key infrastructure, we get some kind of group element, and then we need to condense it to a bit string to be used for AES. So it is very important that we need to deal with such sources. And of course, we need to ask ourselves, what is the minimal assumption that we need to have about our sources so that we have some hope at all to do something? And it turns out that the right assumption is to assume that the source has entropy, and the right form of entropy in this case is called mean entropy, which says that for any outcome little x, the probability of hitting that particular outcome is at most 2 to the minus m. So this letter m is going to be called the entropy of our source. And the big question, of course, is can we extract nearly perfect randomness from such realistic imperfect sources? So this question is very well known. It received a lot of attention. And the right primitive is called randomness extractor. It does exactly what it says. You know, it takes a source, imperfect source x, and output a random string r. Unfortunately, this is too good to be true. So it turns out that to make it work, you also need some short random seed s to go along with x. And then you extract this key r. And of course, you might ask the question, if I already have a random seed s, why don't I just use s? The point is s is public, x is secret. So we want the extracted bits to be random, even if s is completely public and known to the attacker. So even condition X, the extracted bits should be random. And it's a very important primitive. It has many usages well beyond key derivation. But for perspective of this talk, let's really think about our basic problem. We have imperfect sources and we want to derive a key for AES, for example. Okay, so very briefly, let's go through the parameters. There are a lot of them, but all the letters will be introduced in this slide. So first, mean entropy M, already defined. Output length V, we would like to extract as many bits as possible. Well, hopefully at least 128 for AES. But here, for most of the talk, I will be talking about an equivalent measure, which is the entropy loss, which is the difference between the entropy that we have and the number of bits that we extract. So if we have 100 bits of entropy and extracted 80 bits, we lost 20 bits. Notice this quantity could also be negative. Sometimes, you know, we really have only 100 bits, like, you know, some small elliptic curve or something like that, but we want to extract 128 bits. Maybe we are not going to lose all the security. So sometimes this quantity could be negative if we are really unlucky. Then there is this error epsilon. So this is a statistical error, which is the best advantage a computational unbounded attacker can have in distinguishing extracted bits from random bits. And that defines security parameter k, which is log 1 over epsilon. And finally, there is a seed length n, how many extra bits we need in order to achieve this task. So the optimal parameters turn out to be pretty good. The seed length is logarithmic, is essentially linear insecurity parameter. And the entropy loss, sorry for this really annoying green color, but the entropy loss is 2 log 1 of epsilon. And the question, of course, is can we measure them efficiently because those are existential results. It just shows that a random function achieves this kind of very good parameters. And sometimes, you know, when a question is asked in 96, you have to look back at some yesterday leftovers to see maybe we already know the answer, and it turns out we already know the answer, or at least some answer. And this is given exactly by the leftover hash lemma, which is really a beautiful thing. It's an amazing thing. I don't know if the inventors of the lemma anticipated the amount of applications it would have. But essentially, it says that universal hash functions are good extractors. So let me briefly remind you what universal hash functions are. Essentially, it's a family of functions such that for any two distinct inputs, the probability, if you give me two distinct inputs and choose a hash function at random, the probability of collision is as low as it can get, which happens to be 1 over 2 raised to the v. So leftover hash lemma says universal hash functions are good extractors. So let's look at the parameters. So the entropy loss happens to be 2 log 1 of epsilon, which is optimal. So this is great news. Unfortunately, the seed lengths, it turns out, even though the definition of universal hash function is so simple, they must have seed lengths at least linear in the source length. So if we have some physical, I don't know, some kind of noise, which is like 1 megabyte long or something like that, we need a seed length of length 1 megabyte or something like that. So this is not so good. But on the other hand, despite this, there are a lot of advantages. It's very simple to construct universal hash functions. They're order of magnitude faster than cryptographic hash functions. So they're like very, very fast if you know what you're doing. And they also have some nice algebraic properties, which were recently used for designing public key cryptosystems, resilient to leakage, and so on. But the cons, unfortunately, the first cons is kind of obvious that the seed length is large. But also, I'll argue that even the entropy loss is pretty large. So I'm going to explain both of those disadvantages of the leftover hash lemma in a second. This is, roughly speaking, the two parts of our talk. We're going to improve both of those disadvantages of this beautiful invention of leftover hash lemma. So let's start with the first one, improving the entropy loss. Like, this guy has pretty severe entropy loss. So we'll try to kind of improve it in the setting of leftover hash lemma. So let's ask two questions. The first question we'll ask it, is it important? Because I already told you it's like such a small entropy loss. Who cares? Well, the answer is definitely yes, especially if you talk to practitioners, because many sources of randomness, they just do not have this 2 log 1 over epsilon, let's say 160 or 200 bits of extra randomness lying around, like biometric physical sources. And even when we control the source, like if you want to do Diffie-Hellman key exchange on elliptic curves of the smallest possible size, we can control the size, but we still need the size to be large enough to extract randomness. So here we don't want to like unnecessarily increase the size of elliptic curve by like 320 bits or something like that. So this is like very important even when we control the source in some sense. And also the other motivation is in practice, we all, as a theoretician, we all love leftover hash lemma, but in practice people are just going to use some hash function like SHA without understanding that it wasn't designed to be randomness extractor. We had a paper at Crypto 5 about the soundness of this idea. And this idea, if you really make this heuristic random oracle assumption, such extractors are actually very good. I will put a formula a little bit later, but just trust me, I put it in quotes, that cryptographic, this idealistic, non-existing cryptographic hash functions have no entropy loss. So we have a stiff competition. We have entropy loss 2 log 1 of epsilon. This guy have no entropy loss. So as end result, practitioners, of course, even though the leftover hash lemma is so beautiful, they just say, we don't care. Let's just use cryptographic hash functions and, don't worry about anything, everything is fine. So our goal, at least initial goal, would be to reduce, provably reduce this 2 log 1 of epsilon entropy loss of leftover hash lemma and to make it closer to no entropy loss of heuristic extractors. So the second question is, well, it's a great goal, you want to compete with random oracle, good luck, but you just told us that this is optimal, so how can we improve 2 log 1 of epsilon if it's already optimal? It turns out the proof of optimality of this entropy loss is if you care about all kinds of possible computation and boundary distinguishers, which do kind of everything. In cryptography, actually, we care intuitively about a restrictive class of distinguishers, at least for the task of key derivation, which will be the point of this talk. So informally, and I'll make it a little bit more precise, is the kind of distinguishers that we care about meeting a cryptographic definition is we have some kind of signature scheme or something like that, is a distinguisher who plays the game between the attacker and a challenger, some well-defined game, like existential unforgeability or something like that, and the distinguisher output one if the attacker won the game. So there is some restrictions, there is some kind of structure on this distinguisher, so maybe the lower bound doesn't apply. So to make it less abstract, let's look at the case study, let's say key derivation for signatures of max. So here we know that the signature is secure with ideal keys, and what we would hope is that the probability suddenly if I plug instead of ideal key, I plug the extracted key, the probability doesn't jump up too much from epsilon to epsilon prime. So the key insight is that in the ideal model, essentially the distinguisher almost never outputs one. Because if he outputs one, the signature is insecure in the ideal model, so we shouldn't use it with extracted randomness, definitely. We shouldn't use it even with perfect randomness. So in this case, the distinguisher, for example, is very restricted because we know that it almost never outputs one. So maybe we can circumvent this lower bound and improve it. And indeed, this is what our results are. So let me first formalize the setting and then briefly state our results. So we have this application P, which needs a V-bit secret key R. In the ideal model, we just sample a uniform key. In real model, we'll apply the extractor, where the mean entropy of the source will be V plus L, plus entropy loss. And we would like to have good results. So we need to assume that the application was epsilon secure in the ideal model. And we would like to conclude that the application is epsilon prime secure in the real model. And with this kind of notation, it's pretty straightforward to translate the leftover hash lemma. I didn't put the parameters, but trust me. The bound becomes that epsilon prime is at most the original security, and the security drops by this factor, which is, turns out to be exactly the statistical distance that we are talking about. So our result says that for a wide range of applications P, which I'll define in two slides from now, the security is improved. In particular, there is an extra term epsilon under the square root. So this is kind of an improved bound. So the moral is you might extract more if you know why you're extracting, which is a special kind of case of a general philosophy in life. If you know what you're doing, you can get better results. So we kind of applied it for the setting of leftover hash lemma. So let's give you a brief comparison between all the bounds and, you know, take a look at the paper because, you know, just trust me, it's also the bounds. So this is the bound of the standard leftover hash lemma, which kind of says that if you want comparable security, the entropy loss has to be at least 2 log 1 of epsilon, which is exactly what I said. And this bound, unfortunately, is also not minimal if you need to extract more than what you have. Even if you have a super secure 2 to the minus million secure application, you know, suddenly all this 2 to the minus million security is lost, you know, when you have no entry, you know, when L is equal to 0. So random oracle heuristic, it turns out we kind of do this bound, but this turns out to be the right bound for the random oracle heuristic, which is much better in multiple terms. So in particular, as I told you, it suffices to have even when L equals to 0, you already get comparable security, and when L goes, you know, becomes more than 0, you essentially reach epsilon. And it's also suddenly, which is what we expect. It is meaningful even when L is less or equals than 0, which is what we expect because suddenly the application doesn't become completely insecure and just like when you turn the switch. For example, if the first bit of the key is always 0 but the rest is truly uniform, you kind of know that you will lose at most a factor of 2. So it's nice that we borrow a little bit from the application even if we extract more than what we have. And here, this is our result. And this is how we, so we didn't quite match the heuristic, you know, random oracle model, but we at least made headway. We are kind of halfway in between. We already achieved comparable security when L is log 1 of epsilon. And just like this bound, our bound is meaningful for L less or equal than 0. For example, for no entropy loss, maybe we don't get fantastic security, but at least we get something like square root of epsilon. All right, so very briefly, which applications? All unpredictability applications. So whenever the attacker has to forge something or, you know, output kind of a long string, like max signature, one-way function, and so on. Also, prominent and most surprising result, which we don't have time to talk about, is we actually showed that this holds for essentially all important indistinguishability applications, not all, but most, like chosen plaintext, chosen ciphertext, secure encryption scheme, something called weak pseudorandom functions. Unfortunately, it doesn't work for all. For example, it doesn't work for pseudorandom functions, stream ciphers, and one-time pad, which in some sense is expected. But I want to make a very quick note. It is okay, you know, if you use one of those red applications, but you use it as a building block for a green application, for a good application, it's fine. So it's okay to derive AES key, even though AES is a PRP, which is red, but you want to design, you know, derive it to get a MAC or an encryption scheme, this is fine. We only care about the final application. And a simple observation is, if you care about red applications, which sometimes, you know, some people do, here is a quick, simple trick that you can kind of first extract a key for a weak PRF and compose it, evaluate it on a random point. And because weak PRF is green, you get a key which is good for all applications, including this, but not one-time pad because we use a computational primitive. So essentially, I can cover all applications. The cost is meaningful. It's one extra call to AES, and the seed becomes a little bit longer because I need to contain the random point. All right, so let me move to the second part of the talk, which is improving the seed lengths. So the approach, I'm going to define an approach which I call expand and extract. So first, let's recall that the best seed length for leftover hash lemma is order of security parameter. Unfortunately, leftover hash lemma, I just told you, requires a really big kind of seed. So what do we do if we want to have a short seed and we need a big seed? We apply a pseudorandom generator. So the idea is we'll assume we have a pseudorandom generator G. It has a short seed S, but then we'll expand it and apply leftover hash lemma on top of it. So now we have a very short seed, And so this is very friendly to like streaming sources. You know, the source can come online, and it can result in very fast implementations because both stream ciphers and universal hash functions are blazingly fast. So the hope is that the extracted bits are pseudo-random because we use, you know, computational assumption, but this is fine. But the question is this idea sound? So at first it appears almost as a triviality. Of course, it's sound, you use a pseudorandom generator, it's, you know, otherwise you break pseudorandom generator. But the trivial implication is actually not what we want if you think about it. It only tells you that the extracted bits are pseudorandom even if I give you the long pseudorandom seed. But I don't want to give you a long pseudorandom seed because then I might as well have a long random seed. What I want is that the output looks random even if I give you the short seed, which is used to expand the big seed. So it's not so obvious, right? And indeed, our first observation is that under a well-established assumption from public key cryptography called decisional Diffie-Hellman assumption, there exists a pseudorandom generator, in fact, a very natural pseudorandom generator, and a universal hash function, again, relatively natural universal hash function, which is therefore an extractor, such that this thing, not only is it false, but it is as false as it can get. We can distinguish this probability almost one on any source, even uniform distribution on any source. So therefore, unfortunately, our brilliant idea is not sound in general. Okay, so this is the first thing, but I'm not going to stop here. Despite this bad news, I'm going to have some good news. The first good news is we are going to show that it is okay to extract small number of bits. More specifically, despite this counterexample, which I didn't show you, it is okay to extract the number of bits, which is roughly speaking log of the security of the pseudorandom generator. A bit more formally, it means that the pseudorandom generator should be secure against attackers who run on time exponential in the number of output bits. The other thing, which is kind of subtle but was very surprising, remember I told you that we expect to settle for computational security? It turns out here we actually still get statistical security. So we use a computational assumption of a pseudorandom generator in a weird part of the proof, but we get a regular extractor, you know, standard extractor this way. And, you know, there it drops to square root of epsilon, but that's a little bit of a technicality. But still, it's somewhat of a surprising result. So the corollary is that if you want to extract logarithmic number of bits from the, you know, like one coin flip, you want to decide if you go to a soccer game or to an opera, that's okay. Or if you assume exponentially strong pseudorandom generators, it's okay to extract even linear number of bits. Unfortunately, if you look at the seed lengths, at best it has to be log of the security of pseudorandom generator, which turns out to be this. And if you want this seed length, there are already very simple relaxations of universal hash functions called almost universal hash functions, which already achieve it. So it's great that we use this big hammer of pseudorandom generators, but, you know, it's surprising that the result still works given our counterexample, but the parameters on the seed lengths are still not the greatest. So I'm not going to stop here. So the most surprising result, which is the last thing that I'm going to tell you, will show that the expand and extract approach is secure in this hypothetical world, which is called minicrypt. So let me explain this result and also convince you why we should care about this result. So the counterexample we had, it used a very simple assumption, natural assumption, DDH assumption, but that's an assumption from public key world. And here we extract keys for AES and so on. So it's kind of weird why we used a public key assumption for a counterexample. So the world minicrypt is one of these beautiful worlds of Rustin and Palazzo where we assume that symmetric key cryptography is possible, but public key cryptography is impossible, just as a sort of experiment. And our theorem says that in this hypothetical world where public key encryption doesn't exist, but pseudorandom generators exist, this approach is always secure. And this is true for any number of extracted bits, so you don't need like logarithmic number or something. But of course, just as we expect now, we need to settle for efficiently samplable sources, which is fine, and also for computational security, which is fine, which is what we were hoping from the beginning. And it's similar in spirit to some other beautiful results of this kind, but arguably simpler. So let me actually, now, we have this one-line theorem. I'll expand it to a three-line theorem, which I can prove in 1 minute, so that Tal doesn't yell at me. So the theorem, so what are we trying to prove? We try to prove that expand as an extract approach is secure in minicrypt. So we prove it by contradiction. So assume not. Assume there exists some efficiently samplable source and some pseudorandom generator and some distinguisher who can tell it apart, right? So the approach is insecure. We need to get a contradiction. The contradiction in the world of minicrypt means we need to build a public key encryption, which would be a contradiction, right? So this is a statement. And the public key encryption is really simple. The secret key is a seed for a pseudorandom generator. The public key is an output of a pseudorandom generator. And to encrypt a bit, here is what I do. If I want to encrypt one, I send a random string. If I want to encrypt zero, I sample my source X, I apply extractor to X in public key, and send the output. How do I decrypt? That's, of course, a big question. And here I assume this hypothetical distinguisher, who actually now knows a short seed, and now he can precisely distinguish encryptions of 0 from encryption of 1. And semantic security follows from a trivial observation, because if you don't know the secret key, you only know the public key, security trivially follows from the security of a pseudorandom generator. All right, great. So why do we care about this result? It's kind of a weird result. Who cares about minicrypt? So here is a corollary, which is an equivalent restatement of the theorem. It says that let G be a pseudorandom generator. And assume there exists no public key encryption of very restricted form. The secret key is a seed S, the public key is G of S. This encryption should have pseudorandom ciphertext, and exact security should be, essentially the security of our PRG. Then we know that the expanded and extract approach is secure with this pseudorandom generator, right? And I argue, and this is the last thing before conclusions, that, practical PRGs like AES, or stream ciphers built from AES, are unlikely to yield such a restrictive and remarkable public key encryption. First, we don't even have a black box construction known of this very restrictive kind. And it is possible from what we know that even if public key encryptions exist, maybe public key encryptions are, in general, much less secure than symmetric key encryptions. And indeed, in practice, for RSA, the keys are like 2,000 bits, for AES is 128 bits, so it's kind of conceivable that forget about this restricted form, we cannot even achieve this, okay? And it would be, I think, overall, if you think about AES, to build such a thing from AES would be like really remarkable. Okay, so the moral is that we give formal evidence and expect an extract approach might be secure as practice with actually used stream ciphers. So the summary is we show that we can improve large entropy loss and seed lengths of LHL. For entropy loss, we go from 2 log 1 of epsilon to log 1 of epsilon. For a lot of green applications, but using the trick with WPRFs, we can use any application. And the seed lengths, essentially the important result that it seems our approach seems to be practical for all pseudorandom generators which don't imply a public encryption scheme. And the paper is available on imprint.
Thank you very much. Okay, so we don't have time for questions because you ran over a little bit. So where is the person? The tech